The following program is brought to you by Caltech.
Just to have a complete picture of the options we're talking about, even though the foci for the rest of the week will be on stratospheric aerosols and little clouds, but I think it's really important to ground us. So. We have an hour for this talk, and if you could leave 20 minutes for Q&A. I'm sorry, an hour total.
You know how that
an
goes.
Hour total. We're going to cut you off at 20 minutes, too.
So. Right. You know how that goes. And, of course, I have too many slides. Thanks, Riley. So, actually, we are kind of bleeding into the mitigation and geoengineering side of things, whether we liked it or not. So I'm going to talk... I'm going to talk about black carbon and dust. This is a little bit hard to see, but this was last week, and this is here with a shovel in her hand and snow in the blade, and over there is Lori Garver, who's the deputy administrator of NASA. And I guess it's a historical moment that a scientist has had 5 days with an administrator or a deputy administrator. You know what? It was actually fantastic. So, anyway, this is my excuse for how scattered my slides are. So my apologies. So I'm going to start out talking about just the fundamentals of the radiation and snow melt and glacier melt. What is it that controls the melt? Then I'll talk about observations from the globe. What limited information we actually have from around the globe, where we know the impact well, largely in the Upper Colorado River Basin, and then what then are the implications for where we don't know the impacts well. Geoengineering, the efforts that are going on right now, colors, sorry about that. And then leading into mitigation and how do we make the observations that we really need that will begin to fill in. So there's been a great deal of discussion in the last few years related to the atmospheric brown clouds. This is a shot from Mara Peak near Mount Everest, looking off to the south and showing one of those atmospheric brown clouds that Ram Ramanathan has focused on so heavily. And these lap up against the foothills of the Himalaya, but occasionally they get punched through monsoonal flow up and over the Himalaya and deposited into the mountain snow and ice. Dust storms also are carried through. This is in the Upper Colorado, taken for those of you from Colorado, there are a few of you here. This is from the summit of Mount Sneffels, looking out across to about, I think they're about 14,000 foot peaks showing here. And this was in the spring of 2009 when we saw a particularly heavy dust load. So as I mentioned, there's been heavy emphasis on black carbon. This, while there were papers previous to this, it really in the last few years got a big kickstart from Jim Hansen's paper in 2004 that used a fairly unrealistic scenario of a 5% absolute drop in snow albedo. But this again kicked off several papers. And a great deal of new effort, either in Tibet or even in the Western U.S. And then Ram's recent work looking at, this is largely black carbon in the atmosphere, the atmospheric heating. And then Ming Jing's work recently in Western China. But I want to emphasize here, black carbon in the snow of glaciers in West China and its potential effects on albedos. So for the most part, we don't have the measurements from around the globe. The other thing to keep in mind as we go through this this talk, and I'm going to focus mostly on dust, apologies to Alan and Brian who've seen this talk quite recently. This is the albedo reduction caused by black carbon relative to dust concentration, right? And then for varying concentrations of that black carbon. So as the dust concentration increases, the ability of the black carbon to influence the albedo decreases. Okay, and as we'll see in a bit, the dust concentrations we see in the Upper Colorado and we infer to be in other parts of the world, can reach greater than the parts per thousand. So black carbon in those areas can't really have an effect. So how does this play out? So the dust influences the albedo primarily. This is the energy balance equation. These are some energy balance components in the Senator Beck Basin, where we have two energy balance towers in southwest Colorado. A particularly warm series of days as well, 13 to 15 C max temperatures. The black trace here represents the net flux. That's the energy available for snowmelt. And then the net solar is the red trace. Essentially, the sun dominates the snowmelt, right? And the sensible heating terms, even though it's very high temperatures, still, those are largely balanced by the net long wave and the latent cooling term in this case. So a modulation of the temperature is not going to have a huge impact, whereas a modulation of the albedo has the driving impact on the energy available for melt. So how does that play out? This is in the upper Colorado. This is at the Mordorach Gletscher in a paper by Hans Orlemans. Total of energy available for melt. Here's the net shortwave. So how does this work? Well, the first is just the contrast in the optical properties of ice, which is the what makes up the snowpack, and then the dust itself. And that happens primarily in the visible wavelengths, as I'll show in a second. The next is that dust generally comes in the spring, and that's during the period in which the snowpack is warming, the sun's getting higher in the sky, and there's less precipitation that can follow up to cover those dust layers. So if dust came primarily in December and then was covered by the heavy spring precipitation, then it wouldn't really have an effect. Finally, and every bit as important, is that dust generally accumulates in the layer into which it was deposited. And that's shown by these figures that are staggered by a month. This is at Rabbit Ears Pass in Colorado. So about as far away from dust sources in the upper Colorado River Basin as you can be. And in 1 month's time, these three layers then have merged into this single layer. And no dust is infiltrating into the snowmelt. So the dust keeps itself as close to the surface as possible. It's kept there by the matrix of snow, and it can continue to have its impact darkening as the season progresses. Okay, so this is just for clean snow. These are the spectral albedos. In the visible wavelengths, it's largely insensitive to the particle size. Whereas as we step out to where ice becomes more absorptive, then the greatest sensitivity lies here in the near infrared. Out in the shortwave infrared, we only have a real sensitivity when the particle sizes are quite small. So for most particle sizes of snow, the snow reflectance, snow is essentially black out in the shortwave infrared. But the big contrast comes in the visible wavelengths when dust and black carbon are introduced. And important to note is that about half of the solar irradiance comes in those visible wavelengths. So dust is having a big impact in the part of the spectrum where there is a large contribution of irradiance. And then I like to argue that snow actually is the most colorful surface on the planet. It is certainly the one that goes through the greatest range of albedos. And I think I don't have the figure in here, but we have observed snow albedo ranging from about 0.9 down to 0.33. That's what you saw from Colorado with that very heavy dust loading. And these are measured spectral albedos that we've taken in the field with a field spectrometer. These are directional reflectances, but just to show that broad range. And then this heavy dust loaded albedo is down around 0.33. Okay, and how does that play out, the concentration? So it's really important, especially as we get to the remote sensing aspect of this. So these are for varying concentrations of black carbon. The clean spectral albedo here, the brightest, of course. And then we introduce 10 parts per billion of soot, and we start to see that impact in the visible wavelengths. But as the concentration increases, the impact increases in wavelength, right? And it does so continuously.
Sorry, how thick a layer of soot is it? Or is the concentration through how deep a layer?
This is the near surface concentration. Okay, so actually, this Yeah, this is the concentration in the top centimeter of the snowpack. And then it's clean snow underneath that.
And PBPW is in
parts per billion by weight.
By weight.
Right. Okay.
Is that the mass of aerosol in the mass of snow?
That's right.
Okay.
Right. Right. So we define, just as with clouds, we need to define the radiative impact. So the direct effect is the absorption in the visible and the near infrared directly by the dust or the black carbon. Okay. And I say here for large concentrations. So as the concentration increases, that impact reaches out into the near infrared. The first indirect effect comes from the enhanced grain growth. So the increased absorption in the snowpack accelerates snow metamorphism, and that leads to coarser grains. Coarser grains have larger absorbing path lengths for photons, and that further depresses the snow albedo. And then the second indirect effect comes simply from the earlier exposure of a darker substrate. And key in the snow albedo feedback. I'm just going to push past these since I know I have too many slides. Okay, so observations from the globe. So this is the Upper Colorado. Again, this is taken very near Telluride. And this photo was in the LA Times, on the cover of it. Well, it was embedded in the LA Times. It was in Le Monde in France, and all the way out to newspapers in Urumqi. So that particular year, the rest of the globe was very interested in the Western Colorado snow albedo.
Decreasing tourist trade to Colorado.
Well, perhaps. So the albedo in this year reached down at our towers, which are just over the divide over here, reached down to about 0.33 for the last 3 weeks of snow cover. Now that doesn't fall in the usual range of albedos in the textbooks. Relatively clean snow aged through a season has an end of season albedo of about 0.7. So that represents more than a doubling of the net solar radiation by the snowpack. Now, how do you get, for that relatively clean snow, how would you get the same amount of radiation into the snowpack? Well, you would have to move that snowpack and the Earth closer to the Sun than Venus. Okay? More than a doubling of the solar irradiance. Now, the vegetation and humans wouldn't do very well under that kind of scenario, and the snowpack doesn't either. The projector's not punching it out quite as much. Anyway, it does show a good contrast. This is showing some of the broad dust exposure on the Alaskan glaciers. And Lonnie Thompson has a graduate student that is publishing a dissertation here soon that has shown that over the last 30 to 40 years, there's been somewhere between a tripling and a quadrupling of dust deposition into Alaskan glaciers. That's consistent with the increase in dust emission coming out of the Gobi and the Taklamakan deserts of Asia. This is Mount Kosciuszko in Australia. Considerable dust load into that mountain snowpack. And then coming out of the plains of the Himalaya and blasting into the Indian Himalaya, we see the same thing in the Hindu Kush and further east into Nepal. And you can see that exposure of dust in those mountain snow covers. Ah, yes, this is the Hindu Kush as well. One of the large haboobs blowing out across the plains and up into the snow cover. Here's an oblique shot of that mountain snow cover. And then finally, the Tian Shan, and downwind of the Aral Sea, which has seen considerable increases in its dust emission. And we don't really know for sure that all of this dust or even how much of this dust is coming out of the Aral Sea. There's been considerable land disturbance that is downwind of the Aral Sea. So much yet to find out. And then I guess finally now back into the Mount Everest region. And this is looking up Mara Peak with Mount Everest behind us. And
considerable dust exposure, and this runs all the way up to about 6,400 meters before giving way to relatively new, clean snow. Okay, so what limited information do we have about these changes globally? So again, Lonnie Thompson had some other work from the Dasu-Upu Corps from 2000, and he showed that since about 1850, there's been a fourfold increase in dust load. This is recently confirmed by Jessica Conway and Jonathan Overpeck from lake sediments further out into southwest Tibet. In the Caucasus, there's been a considerable increase in dust load. This began somewhere around the 1930s. The Antarctic Peninsula has seen roughly a doubling, about a little more than a doubling, of dust accumulation. And this was coincident, starting in about the 1930s, coincident with the introduction of large numbers of sheep into Patagonia. And when you look at the circulation patterns, it's not surprising that we see a dust increase in the Antarctic Peninsula. So where do we know the impact well? So this is the Upper Colorado River Basin, and again, that these dust concentrations that we're seeing out here are on the order of parts per thousand. So lake sediments that we performed in, I think it was in 2006 and 2007 at high elevations. From that, we found that over the last 5,000 years, leading up until about 1850 or so, there was relatively stable dust loading into those high elevation regions, but coincident with the disturbance of the western U.S., largely from grazing by cattle and sheep, and then subsequently energy exploration, there was about a sevenfold increase in dust load. Now, there are two decreases in here that are kind of squeezed in because of the log scale, but there was a massive die-off in the sheep population in the late 1890s and bleeding into about 1910. And then the Taylor Grazing Act is coincident with this drop. The Taylor Grazing Act removed large numbers of grazing animals from the public lands. But it appears that we have stabilized somewhat, although we don't really have the resolution from these lake sediments. Nevertheless, the snowpack now is dirtier because of this 5 to 7-fold increase in dust load. And before we had done those lake sediments, it was largely predicted because of the work by Jane Belknap, Rich Reynolds, Marith Reheis, all with the USGS, who had been looking at crust disturbance in the Colorado Plateau and the Mojave Deserts, the Sonoran and the Great Basin. These are results of sediment movement, so essentially dust accumulation, for various soils. And this, I think, result is particular to the Colorado Plateau. And you can see that in essentially every case, disturbance creates a massive increase in that dust load. And in general, desert surfaces are armored by crusts. They're armored by physical crusts and biological crusts, cryptobiotic soils. And remember that prior to the 1850s, 1860s, in the Colorado Plateau, out into the Great Basin and beyond, we didn't have the herds of buffalo. They weren't roaming back and forth, tearing it up. It was largely unpopulated. The deer populations were quite small. They stayed in the riparian areas, and did not wander out because it's very, very dry out in those deserts. And so that region was essentially a stable surface, not a non-disturbed or non-dust emitting surface. Okay, and these dust sources, of course, are regional as I'm describing. These are in the Navajo Nation, starting out in the Little Colorado Band. There's a road that comes across here, considerable disturbance here. And many of you, I would guess, have driven through the Navajo Nation and seen this transformed surface. There's very little vegetation, essentially no cryptobiotic soils, and considerable source material. This is now moving up to central Utah, and You can see the Great Salt Lake right up here. A couple of dust plumes here. We'll highlight these from the MODIS retrieval. And then there are other dust plumes coming out of the Great, actually these are out of Nevada. The Great Salt Lake Desert is also emitting, but it's covered by clouds here. And then this particularly bright plume is the Milford Flat Fire Scar. In 2007, well, before 2007, this plume was not showing up on the remote sensing retrievals. In 2007, the Milford Flat Fire was the largest wildfire in Utah history. After the fire, the state of Utah and the Bureau of Reclamation went in to apply general rangeland practice, which is to revegetate areas and get the grazing animals back onto the surface as soon as possible. Unfortunately, they had not studied the soils that they were going out to, and there were several thousand acres of cryptobiotic soils. Very, very stable, no grasses, interspersed by shrubs. And when they broke through those to reseed the areas, they essentially broke into ancient Lake Bonneville sediments, which are very loose materials. And now, this plume, essentially every time the wind blows at all, it's funneled through the topography here and into Provo, Orem, and Salt Lake City. I lived 3 years of inhaling that. And the EPA has now been looking at this very carefully because in the last 3 to 4 years since that fire, so I guess this is now the fourth full year, Salt Lake City has been exceeding particulate levels, violating those severely. And then what do we face out into the future? So this is a paper by Seth Munson and others, including Greg Oken at UCLA. And what they're finding in the upper Colorado is that there's this exponential response of aeolian sediment, so sediment flux, related to the mean annual temperature in the previous year. And this largely related to a decrease in canopy cover. So as the West heads into a warmer climate, then we may well be heading into increases in dust emission. And this is not just in the West, but other parts of the globe. Okay, so so how does this translate into to the impact on snowmelt? So we have two towers in the San Juan Mountains. We have another tower in on the Grand Mesa, and then we're working towards building a new broader network in the upper Colorado. We have the general energy balance measurements, but we also have additional radiation measurements that allow us to infer the impacts of dust on the radiative forcing. And so we can then remove that dust radiative forcing from a snowmelt model. These are several years of data, and the spaghetti translates into the black curve, which is described as dust now. This is current conditions, current meteorology, and current dust load. And then measured SWE are the diamonds here. And so we do quite well with the snowmelt modeling. Now, we can remove the dust radiative forcing on an hourly basis and watch how the snow water equivalent evolves. And so not surprisingly, the snowpack is lasting longer. The difference in meltout days is represented on top of each of these bars. And so over 2005 through 2009, we saw a dust forcing in terms of snowmelt, complete snowmelt, of about 26 to 50 days difference in meltout. So a month to nearly 2 months difference in meltout. And then we ran the scenarios with the cleaner snowpack under scenarios of increases in temperatures of plus 2 and plus 4. And those impacts run on the order of 5 up to 15 days difference. So not surprisingly, the dust has a bigger impact, but that's just where there is snow, so not in those areas where there's not snow. And then how do the two work together? Well, in general, the increases in temperature don't really force the melt that much more. And that's because the acceleration by the dust is so potent that the increases in temperature can't really keep up. And that's not surprising given what we saw from those time series of the energy balance components. Now, extrapolating those results from our energy balance towers to the whole of the upper basin, we used the VIC model, the variable infiltration capacity hydrology model, and used the scenarios of dust forcing in 2005 through 2008, so not including the big year of 2009. And then we cleaned the snowpack up to about 5 times less dust, so back to that scenario of pre-disturbance, to try to understand how the hydrology of the upper Colorado has changed with that disturbance in the western U.S. And the results suggest, first of all, not surprisingly, that right now, so post-disturbance is present day, there's a steeper rising limb. For hydrologic management, that is a tough scenario because any kinds of mistakes that occur in the capture and release of water from reservoirs at various scales have bigger implications. And those implications translate directly into dollars. The other is that there's about a 3-week earlier peak because of the dust, and that then moves the mass earlier in the year and loses that mass out further when the hydroelectric generation is important for the warmer temperatures, electricity being generated, air conditioning needing to run. And then also, it pushes the agriculture earlier in the season as well, whereas that mass would be coming out later in the season. And then finally, there's about 5% less total runoff. And this is due to a more protracted growing season and therefore more protracted evapotranspiration. That's not necessarily the case everywhere. It's important that there's the monsoon into the upper Colorado, and that meets some of the evaporative demands and balances this out. In the Sierra Nevada, in fact, under the dusty conditions, you would see less runoff because of the time at which that snowmelt would be coming and the ET would begin. Okay, so what are the implications for where we don't know the impact well? I just give these as a list. So the first is that we know that warming the snowpack increases its sublimation rates. So through the Clausius-Clapeyron relation, say an increase in temperature from -5 to 0°C, that results in about a 50% increase in saturation vapor pressure. So that more mass is available. There's accelerated snowmelt and retreat of snow cover. And in turn, that can markedly increase the energy fluxes to glacier ice. It also appears that the dust loading is heaviest, not surprisingly, in the lower elevations, so most heavily impacting and expanding ablation zones of glaciers. And there are, of course, strong sensitivities to this, to the temporal dynamics of snow cover. For instance, this spring in Colorado, there's been a huge record-breaking accumulation of snowfall. There are several dust layers in the snowpack right now, but they continue to be buried. And so we're about to get to June 1st, and we've seen very little radiative forcing by dust. All right. So geoengineering efforts thus far. So we performed one back in 2006 up at Niwot Ridge with scrapers, so long-handled scrapers. We went out, and remember, the dust stays near the surface, so it's easy to access. And so for 5 by 20 meter plots up at Niwot Ridge, we scraped the dust off that we could access, and then removed that snow, and came back 10 days later, and we found about 35 centimeters of differential melt. And at 30 days, we saw over a meter of differential melt. Okay, so it can, in fact, have an impact. Now, there are others that are pursuing geoengineering. This is on the Gershon Glacier at Andermatt. And I'm going to key into some videos here in a second. And then this is the Chalon Sombrero, what used to be a glacier in Peru, and then Jason Box, who's at Ohio State, a former office mate of mine. Let me get back.
If you think heroes are only in movies,
sorry about the ad.
Over 70% of firefighters are local volunteers. These are our neighbors putting their lives on the line. And when they rely on a battery, there are firefighters everywhere who trust Duracell. And now you can join with Duracell.
Fire particulates do impact snow melt as well.
And Duracell will make a battery donation to local volunteers. These days, don't we all need someone to trust? Duracell, trusted everywhere.
There's a very strange sight high up in the Swiss Alps. Two massive blankets protecting thousands of meters of snow on the last glacier. They've been there since the spring and won't come off until the fall.
The problem here is that they have only a few meters snow every year. A few years ago it was up to 10 meters and now it's between 4 and 6 meters.
The world's glaciers have been affected dramatically by global warming.
Notice the albedo of the surface.
They're disappearing at an alarming rate. The top of this mountain range, for example, was completely covered by snow in 1960. Today, it's bare.
I think tourism is among the top five money earners for many of the alpine countries. And, well, for each degree of warming, the snow line rises by about 150 meters. Plus, some of the glaciers are also used for skiing today.
How big is
and
about?
If they disappear
0.4.
Partially or totally, of course, this is going to be a big loss for the income of many ski resorts.
These blankets provide a short-term solution. Without them, the snow would have melted months ago, making it impossible for ski operators to open up on time the next season.
This blanket is made of a polypropylene geotextile on the downside, like with a very high tear resistance. This ice protector protects the sun just to go through this blanket and that the snow is not melting during the summertime.
The snow blankets are manufactured in the mountain town of Naples. These silos store the polypropylene granulates that make up the blankets.
Behind me, you can see where the polypropylene
okay,
granulate comes
the,
in and get mixed with this UV stabilization.
All right, now let me move to this one. This is Eduardo Gold, who secured $200,000 from the World Bank,
which the glacier used to generate, and little by little, they are seeing that.
Come on now. All right, well, while that's thinking about that, so here's his scenario. Paint the talus, these big fields of broken rock, white, where there used to be a glacier, to affect a microclimate. And so his first effort is cooling through creating that microclimate. And he eventually wants to cover the whole of the mountain with white paint. But partway through this, he also mentions that he really would like to see, by creating that microclimate, the regrowth of the glaciers there, and which shows that he doesn't quite understand how glaciers ultimately are formed. It's too bad. Ah, well. All right. So.
Isn't that kind of bogus, or is there anything to that?
I think it's bogus. I mean, I honestly, I think it'll help cool things nearby to a degree. I mean, you increase the albedo. Those are rather dark rocks, and we know from walking on those kinds of surfaces, you can have a rather strong long wave emission out of them. But in terms of growing the glaciers, yeah, that's bogus.
But he still got funded.
But he got funded. He got $200,000. All right.
I've got psoriasis.
And now we start with the psoriasis ad. Sorry about that.
I'm thinking, make that dreading.
But it's a little bit like
my red flaky skin patches.
Particulates onto dark surfaces.
More than a haircut. I need some help.
Symptoms have gone from uncomfortable to unacceptable.
So this next one is a little more, it's reasonable in terms of the physics, but it's a little bit unreasonable in terms of the geography. This is Jason Box at Ohio State at Bird Polar Research Center.
Patience.
So say, Tom, I hope you don't have another one. Because the commercials are starting to go in the wrong direction. It's pretty innocuous.
Oh, come on.
You notice the commercials always work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my apologies. Why is this not working? Yeah. It was running just fine. All right, so at any rate, this was a Discovery Channel video. They went out with Jason into Greenland, into the ablation zone, where he had draped out similar tarps. And his proposal is to drape the whole of the ablation zone of Greenland to reduce the melt. Now, so what is it that all of these are doing? They're all trying, essentially, despite some of their loose grasps on the physics, they're all trying to increase the albedo. And what they don't speak to is the fact that there are other constituents there that are reducing the albedo. And
for most people, it's just another haircut.
Let me get rid of the psoriasis. I'll go back in here. Yeah, yeah. So what are they trying to do? They're trying to essentially increase the albedo. Well, there are other ways of going about that, and that's to reduce the particulate deposition to the mountain snow and ice. And this is one of the things that's been discussed. And the results that I showed from our paper in PNAS with the Upper Colorado, as well as earlier modeling results that we've published, that's gotten the attention of the Bureau of Reclamation, Department of Interior more broadly, water conservancy districts in the Upper Colorado, as well as all the way down to Los Angeles, Metropolitan Water, LADWP, California Department of Water Resources. Because they recognize that as the population increases in the West and potentially the supply of water is going to decrease, their ability to quantify their water resource as well as manage it easily is becoming more and more critical. And so they're wanting to understand what can be done about mitigation of dust into the mountain snowpack. And that effort is underway. I can't remember who it was. Somebody mentioned, Mike, you mentioned this morning with respect to black carbon in the polar regions. And I wanted to pull up this result. This was from Joe McConnell's group, and it includes Mark Flanner, who's authored some papers with some of us in the room. So the peak of black carbon deposition into Greenland came about 1910, 1920. And then we started to clean things up, and we saw a reduction in black carbon load coming out of North America. And that, of course, though, translated into a radiative forcing that's shown here. And remember that, or notice that, even though we saw that vast reduction, it didn't reduce back to exactly what it was before. It's still a bit elevated. And we see that in terms of the radiative forcing. And it's perhaps twice what the radiative forcing was prior to that ramp up in industrialization. So is that geoengineering or is that mitigation? I think that's mitigation. We can talk. We'll talk about it.
We argue about what's under which blanket.
Okay. All right. So at any rate, as I mentioned, the Department of Interior, the BLM, Bureau of Reclamation, EPA are all now pushing for dust mitigation in the Upper Colorado River. There are efforts also underway with the Navajo Nation. In the eastern half of the Upper Colorado River Basin, the Navajo Nation is the primary source. At least that's what we see from the big plumes in the remote sensing retrievals. Jane Belknap, who runs the MOAB office of the U.S. Geological Survey, is very famous in China and Africa, largely because of her ability to help them to understand how to restabilize soils. And she has been inoculating disturbed soils in China, or prescribing this, and the Chinese have done this to reestablish cryptobiotic soils and restabilize deserts with some considerable efficacy. And then Ramanathan and others are pushing for the mitigation of black carbon emissions, not just for the atmospheric heating, but also the deposition into mountain snow and ice. And then finally, I think there are three of us in this room that are co-authors on this report by the working group that was commissioned by the Pontifical Academy of Sciences. And in this, not only are we pushing for mitigation of CO2 emissions, but also particulate emissions, dust and black carbon. And this gives me a quick segue into the last part, the remote sensing. So current remote sensing technologies can detect changes in glacier and snow extent, but they don't quantify relative forcings or provide important snow and ice properties such as these others. But airborne and spaceborne imaging spectrometers will soon allow us to make the spatially comprehensive measurements of these surface properties, and in particular that radiative forcing. So I'll wrap it up real quick, Riley. There was a paper that came out just recently, Yun Kyan at PNNL and Mark Flanner spoke to the radiative forcing in the Tibetan Plateau and that impact on the snowpack evolution. But Anil Kulkarni from India was quoted in this article as saying, well, no, the snow cover's not really showing that at all, what these guys were describing in terms of the negative trends. And that was based on their paper analyzing the MODIS record of snow-covered area. Now, they were arguing back and forth, but not about the proper measurement. The proper measurement is the radiative forcing, and we don't have that measurement today. We do not have it. MODIS doesn't give us that. And this is why. So remember that the wavelength at which the impact occurs increases with the concentration. So it's a continuous change. This is what MODIS gives us, right? So just these little slivers. Any kind of topography throws off our ability to infer a snow grain size and to infer a clean snow. Whereas a spectrometer allows us to integrate this ice absorption feature, that gives us the grain size of the snow. We then know what the spectral reflectance is of the clean snow, and therefore we can know what the radiative forcing is. The other issue with MODIS is the spatial resolution. So we're zooming in here in the Mount Everest region again. On the left, MODIS data. On the right, these are Hyperion data, which is a demonstration imaging spectrometer, but of the kind of spatial resolution that we need to start resolving homogeneous patches of snow cover. The MODIS pixels, essentially all of these, are mixed pixels. So we have rock, soil, vegetation mixing in with that snow signal. And it makes it essentially impossible to deconvolve from the radiative forcing signal. So how do we go about this? Right now, we have the Airborne Visible Infrared Imaging Spectrometer, and this is a NASA facility instrument that's situated at JPL. And from that, we can make these kinds of inferences of radiative forcing. So this is in the Upper Colorado. This is a color composite, a true color composite from last year. And then these are the instantaneous radiative forcings, and these are at surface forcings near noon, all right? So with the radiances of about 1,100 watts per meter squared. And what do we have for hope out into the future to treat this globally, other than airborne instruments, which give us access in, say, the Western US or in Europe under certain agreements, but certainly not flying the border between Nepal and China or flying Pakistan or Afghanistan. So the HISPRI mission is a decadal survey mission. It's a tier two mission right now, but it will give us global coverage every 19 days across the full spectrum. And that is right now our hope for these measurements. All right, Riley, I'll stop.